In the library, we have an exhibit over on the side, but for some of you who are not familiar, there is an exhibit of some of Frankie's work, and Ashley Callahan had helped curate that exhibit up at UGA. I had the pleasure of seeing it there and asking if we could actually borrow it to feature here at the library, and the answer was favorable, so we do have that as well for you to enjoy after the presentation if you haven't already. But back to the side, Ashley Callahan has come down from her home in Athens, Georgia. She is an avid author. She really loves the topic of fashion and textiles, and she has a great background. And of course, she's also a curator and has a love and passion for decorative arts. So she has a fascinating history, and I won't talk too much more because she will introduce herself a little bit more to you and get right into the presentation. And again, I will share with you at the end of the presentation some extra little tidbits. So welcome, Ashley. Let's give her a hand.
Hear me? Is this the right line?
Okay. Well, thanks, Virginia, for having me down here to share my research on Frankie. This is a shared passion that we have, so it's been fun to have someone else to get excited with. And thanks to y'all for joining me today. I know you're getting class credit, and I thank you anyway. It's exciting for me to get to share Frankie's story in person and to share these objects in person and to give you a chance to touch them and try some things on, tie some scarves around your neck if you want. So I want to begin by kind of talking about Frankie's life and career, just kind of introducing her story, and I want to highlight some of her scarves, especially ones with connections to Georgia, and I will also share some kind of research stories of how this project came together. So, for the first one. So my talk is based, as Virginia explained, on my research for a book that was published last year by the University of Georgia Press with the Georgia Humanities, and for an exhibition that I put together at the Hargert Rare Book and Manuscript Library at the University of Georgia. And I'm so glad that y'all have some highlights from the exhibition here. That doesn't usually happen, so it is kind of special that they've traveled to show, and I'm really glad that it's this one. And it was helpful as a researcher to have the exhibition and the book going on. I'm a little fearful of it now. Have the exhibition and the book going on at the same time. But I need to... There we go, better balance. It's all about balance. So it's great having the book and the exhibition going on at the same time because I had to look at the objects in different ways. So with the book, I was thinking about how I can use these objects to kind of tell one overall narrative to get the big picture. With the exhibition, I had to write an individual label for each object. So I was looking at, you know, the parts before the whole. So I think working on the two projects at the same time made both of them better. Yes. All right, so I want to start by telling you how I came to do this project. I grew up in Dalton, Georgia, which is up in the northwest corner of the state, and I got my master's degree in the history of American 19th and 20th century decorative arts from the Smithsonian in Washington, D.C. I moved to Athens in 2000 to become the first curator of decorative arts at the Georgia Museum of Art. And pretty quickly after I arrived in Athens, people on campus started telling me about Frankie's hankies. So they knew I liked textiles, and so they wanted me to know about this weird textile collection that they had. But I wasn't quite ready for Frankie yet. I had other projects that I needed to do first, and in, you know, the early 2000s, I wasn't quite ready to face a collection with a lot of 80s polyester scarves. But I kept her in mind. And then not too long after I left the museum to become an independent scholar, which is what I am now, I decided to write about Frankie for Ornament magazine, and I'm still a contributor to Ornament. It's all about kind of art, fashion, and art jewelry. And that article came out in 2011. And then in 2014, I spoke about Frankie to my dad's cousin's garden club in Marietta, and to the Decorative Art Symposium that the Georgia Museum of Art hosts every other year. And those were good projects to kind of get into the research and see what materials I had available and to start to get, you know, an overall picture of her career, and also to kind of test, you know, whether or not people are going to be interested in this topic. And I knew at the symposium that people were interested, because before I even got done with my talk, I could see the glows of their phones on their faces as they were on eBay looking for her scarves. So I thought, okay, people are interested, it's a good topic. For the ornament article, so back in 2011, I got to interview Frankie by telephone with the help of her daughter Peggy. And then for the book and exhibition, which I started about 2018, 2019, I got to go up and meet Frankie and visit with Peggy in Virginia. And the photo on the lower right, the lower left, is from that trip. And Frankie had pretty advanced dementia by that time, so she wasn't really able to share stories or answer many questions. But it was still really special to get to meet her. She was wearing a Greek alphabet scarf. I was wearing a Jimmy Carter scarf representing Georgia. And she was just gracious and charming. And I also had a really nice visit with her daughter Peggy, and it was a great, great experience. So for the research, for all my Frankie research, I had three amazing resources. So I had scarves and papers that she had donated to the University of Georgia in the 1980s. And that's the reading room that you see on the upper right at the Hargrit. And in this room, you get out one box of archival materials at a time. You take one folder out at a time. You go through it all very carefully. It's quiet and peaceful, just a really lovely place to do research. So that was a great source. I also had limited, because of staffing issues and because of the pandemic, access to a huge collection of archival materials that she gave to a small museum in Rome, so the Rome Area History Center. Rome Area History Museum now, I think is the title. And that's that collection right there. It was way less tidy and way less organized, but it was filled with treasures. So though I was generally kind of filthy when I got done going through those boxes, it was still really satisfying because I could find such great information. And then I also had the support of her family. So they would share the materials that they had preserved, and they shared a lot of family stories. So I could text and, what's going on with this? Do you remember this scarf? Who commissioned that? I remember one of the best times was I was going to quote from an email that her daughter Peggy had sent me. So I was like, who is this man who sent the email? And Peggy called me and gave me an hour-long explanation of Frankie's dating history. So it was fascinating. So, let's see. And of course, you know, digital resources keep getting better and better, so I accessed as many online newspapers as I could, and I reached out to libraries that I thought might have information, and I kept close tabs on eBay, and I didn't, you know, I just looked everywhere I could. So the book came out early last year. We had an opening at the Hargrit. Her family all came down, and I even got to write an article for the magazine Antiques on Frankie. But now I'm going to share Frankie's story. So Mary Frances Frankie Barnett was born in Rome, Georgia in 1924. She was the youngest by far of four children. And so the photo on the far side is her with her next youngest sibling, her sister, who was 11 years older. And she demonstrated a skill for fashion and design at a young age. And the Rome area, of course, is home to Barry College. And I recently found, after the book came out, of course, a text where she states that her brothers, who both studied at Martha Barry's Boys Industrial School, which is the precursor to Barry College, used to tell her, Mary Frances, you can do anything, you're a woman. And they explained Martha Barry's success and how Martha Barry used to go to people at the top. She went and she talked to Henry Ford, she talked to Theodore Roosevelt. So early on, Frankie had this example in her life of how women can succeed and succeed outside of the home, and that they should work with industrial and political leaders. And yeah, I wish I could have included that story in the book, but sometimes that's how it happens, and I'm glad I can share it with you now. So. Frankie graduated from high school in 1941, and then she went to Furman University, where she majored in clothing and design. And she exhibited an entrepreneurial streak early on, and she set up a small business in her dorm room where she would help, as she described them, the rich girls get their dresses made for the various parties, so she would help them pick out flattering patterns and fabrics, and then the women who had been sewing them already would continue sewing them. And her father, who worked for the telephone company, had saved enough money for her to go to college for her tuition, but not enough money for books and other expenses. So she really did need to earn some money. And so she began working in college, and she worked. She was a working woman throughout her life. After her junior year of college, she married her childhood sweetheart, Bill Welch, and he was serving in World War II at the time. So they lived briefly in Pensacola, where he was stationed, and they went up to live in Rome for a short time. And while they were in Rome, she taught high school home economics, and she spent a couple summers going to UGA so that she could earn her teacher certification requirements. So the idea of education is a theme that kind of remains important throughout her career. The young couple returned to Furman in 1947, and that photo was taken at Furman. It even showed up in the yearbook one year. And Frankie graduated in 1948, and Bill graduated in 1950. And then they moved to Madison, Wisconsin, so that Bill could pursue his master's degree in U.S. history. So that was an interest that they shared, was the history of our country. While they were in Wisconsin, Frankie both took and taught sewing classes. And she also admired the architect Frank Lloyd Wright, who was living in the area, to the point that she knew when he went to the bank. So she would park her car at a nearby corner, and she would sit in the car and sketch what he was wearing, because she thought that he dressed so perfectly for his size and image. So yeah, she kind of stopped. In 1952, the family, which now included the first of their two girls, Peggy, moved to Alexandria, Virginia, so that Bill Welch could work with the federal government. And Frankie pretty soon started teaching various classes and seminars on fashion and sewing and home economics. And often she focused on how to create a coordinated wardrobe. She also did private consulting, so she would meet with people and go through their closet and tell them what to keep, what to throw out, what to mend or adjust. And she was very careful about not revealing the names of her clients. She said, it's like going to the doctor, I won't share your name, so it was all very private. But through these classes and seminars and private consultations, she started to develop a really impressive network of women in the DC area. And when her career began, most of these women were the wives of appointed officials or elected officials, various diplomats and government leaders, rather than elected or appointed officials themselves. And that, of course, changed some during the course of her career. But even at the beginning, when they were the wives of these leaders, they were often in the media spotlight. So their fashion choices were important. And if you think about DC, people were coming from all parts of the country. So some of them might be coming from smaller towns where they didn't have as much fashion experience. So Frankie helped people with all aspects of their appearance, you know, whole coordinated wardrobe. She would even advise women on the best way to hold a purse when you were being photographed so that it looked attractive. And Frankie soon realized that traveling to lots of different places to get the different elements to help women create a coordinated wardrobe was really incompatible with her young family's schedule. She now had two young daughters. Her daughter Jeannie was born as well. So in 1963, she opened her own shop where all of the elements of a coordinated wardrobe could be found together. So she and her husband purchased a historic building, you see on the far image. It's known as Duval House, and it's in Old Town Alexandria. So Alexandria, Virginia, just south of DC, just across the river. And Old Town, at this point, was not yet the big tourist destination that it is now, so she was kind of part of the rebirth of that part of town. And for the first years of her business, the family lived upstairs and she had the shop downstairs. So it was a very kind of old-fashioned approach to things. She called the shop Frankie Welch of Virginia, and it was immediately successful. It became not only a place to shop, but kind of a place to hang out. She would have all these activities like book signings and fashion shows and various teas and parties. So women just wanted to be there. You know, they wanted to come get good solid fashion advice, they wanted to buy their clothes, but they also just wanted the experience of being there. She sold clothes primarily by American designers in a medium price range. So she was selling things by Oscar de la Renta, Jeffrey Bean, Adele Simpson, Vera Maxwell, and Molly Parnas. So that's her inside the shop. She also sold some of her own designs, in particular this dress, which she called the Frankie. So she was not at all shy about branding and self-promotion, so this is the Frankie dress. It's a fairly simple design, loosely based on a kimono, and she created it initially as a tool for teaching students about various historic waistlines. So you can take this very simple pattern and you can tie it at a natural waist, you can do an empire waistline, you can do a crisscross pattern. So that's how she came up with the idea. And then once she began to market this design, you know, sell it through her shop, the fact that you could tie it all these multiple ways and it had this flexibility was really a good marketing and selling point. So you could make it in different fabrics. You know, the silk drapes very differently than these heavy cottons. You could have different patterns on it. Sometimes she would have different trims on it. So even though it's, you know, one size fits all, fairly simple design, each dress felt different. And one reporter noted that this was the dress that had been to more White House dinners than any other dress, and that women wearing Frankies didn't mind running into other women wearing Frankies at the same parties because each one looked different. So it's one size fits all, so the body's different, the fabrics are different, the patterns are different. So it was a very successful dress that she sold from the early to mid-60s until the mid-80s or so. One of the women who frequented the shop was Virginia Rusk, and her husband was Dean Rusk, and he was Secretary of State from 1961 to 1969, and he, of course, also was from Georgia. So this image is another recent find. It's a newspaper clipping that showed up in some of Frankie's papers from the Rome collection. And it shows Mrs. Rusk with a prominent singer from India and that singer's daughter. And it looks like Mrs. Rusk is wearing a Frankie dress made of an Indian fabric. So you can see the paisley design. So it's either Indian fabric or inspired by Indian designs. So I love that this shows Frankie's influence in dressing a prominent woman who's been photographed in the media and her image is put out there into the public. And it shows that she could, you know, work with that person to come up with a dress, a garment that was special for whatever particular event she was going to. So on one of Virginia Rusk's visits to Frankie's shop, she used to go regularly, she told Frankie that the State Department and the White House needed a new something that they could give as gifts. And she said that it should be something truly American. So Frankie was very aware of the vogue, the current vogue for signature scarves, and that generally means a scarf where the designer's name features prominently, decided that she would make a signature scarf with the Cherokee alphabet. And this was in 1967. So she had seen the alphabet, which is actually a syllabary rather than an alphabet, so those characters represent syllables rather than phonemes, as in our alphabet. But she had seen the Cherokee syllabary described as an alphabet and an old book of her father's on the history of Rome and Floyd County during a visit to her hometown. She considered the Cherokee alphabet to be truly American and to represent her home state and Dean Rusk's home state. And based on family oral history, she also believed that she was part Cherokee. So this, for her, honored her ancestors as well. Current genealogical research does not support this familial connection to the Cherokee, but it's what she was told and what she believed and what the media enjoyed reporting. And I'll come back to that issue, so we'll keep that one in mind. This scarf was well received, and the State Department and the White House did use it as gifts, which is a pretty amazing debut for a scarf designer. It's her first scarf, and the White House was giving it out as gifts. And even with this first scarf, Frankie recognized the possibilities and importance of making the scarf's introduction into an event. So if you have an event, you're going to get media attention, and then the women who are involved in the event and who receive the scarf are going to feel that they're more special and that the scarf is that much more special. So to introduce Cherokee alphabet, she had a fashion show in Alexandria, and using this network of women that she had developed over the years, had all these prominent DC women model for her. And one of the models was the wife of the House Minority Leader and her good friend, Betty Ford. So Betty Ford was there with her to introduce this scarf. The fashion designer Norman Morell also made a skirt from yardage of this scarf. You see that on the right. And so that was kind of an important nod from the American fashion industry saying, yes, we're here with you, we support you. And that dress still survives. I was really excited to find it. So this scarf remained her bestseller throughout her career, and she had it reprinted more than 40 times in a variety of colorways and on different fabrics. She also used the design to make ties and to make tote bags, which is lots of different things, and she used yardage to make outfits like these pantsuits. And one of Frankie's friends was LaDonna Harris. You see her here on the right. And she was and is a prominent Native American rights activist and a member of the Comanche Nation. And she wore one of these pantsuits when she and her husband, who was a congressman from Oklahoma, went on the Dick Cavett Show. Another visitor on the Dick Cavett Show that day was Sly Family Stone. So she had some stiff fashion competition, but I think she held her own. And it just really looked amazing. And she explained to me that she liked wearing the Cherokee alphabet design because it was a conversation starter. It's kind of unusual character, so people would see it and ask about it, and that would give her an opening for talking to them about Native American rights and issues. And I'm really honored to be able to say that Ms. Harris wrote the preface for my book, so that was really great. Her family, her daughters, had already started to recognize the important place that Frankie had in her career, so they'd kind of been encouraging her to remember those stories, and so it was really good timing. Frankie's second scarf in early 1968 was also a high-profile affair, and a couple of the women who worked for Lady Bird Johnson, who was first lady at the time, were frequent visitors to Frankie's shop, and Lady Bird's the one in the white dress. And actually, the white dress came from Frankie's shop. They were very quiet about it, and Kimberly may talk about that this afternoon, but we don't know who designed it, but she bought it from Frankie. So through these women who worked for Lady Bird, Frankie ended up designing a scarf for the first and only fashion show that happened at the White House. And the show had the theme of Discover America in Style, and it featured American designers, and the backdrop for the runway showed a projection of various historic sites and landmarks and beautiful places across the country. So it was this great Americana spectacle, patriotic spectacle. And it was attended by the wives of the governors. There was only one female governor at the time, and she was sick, so it was all wives of the governors, and a few of the designers who were represented, and some other VIPs. And her scarf, and you see it there, used the words Discover America over an abstract shape of the continental U.S., and was executed in red, white, and blue, so very patriotic. And the scarves featured prominently on the runway, and all of the attendees received one as a gift, so it came in a special envelope, and you would have this scarf that you could take home. But actually, the attendees received a temporary scarf, and then were sent professionally manufactured scarves in the mail afterwards. And this fashion show came together very quickly, just like in a few weeks. So Frankie didn't have time to have the scarves professionally manufactured before the event. So she and the White House drafted all these volunteers to go to her shop and hand paint and hand screen print and hem all these scarves that were used at the actual event. So I also want to mention that there's a new book out by Kimberly Chrisman Campbell titled Red, White, and Blue on the Runway. It's all about this fashion show, and it was really fun to have these books in progress at the same time because Kimberly and I were able to share facts and kind of make sure we were both getting everything accurate and really kind of nerd out about our obscure topics. And Kimberly will be doing a Facebook Live event this evening at 6, so I really encourage you to participate in that. She's going to be great. After the fashion show for Lady Bird Johnson, who was a Democrat, Betty Ford came to her friend Frankie and asked for equal time for the Republicans. And they decided that she would design a documentary fabric, and instead of using the traditional elephant motif, she would use the theme of fresh as a daisy. So she created this daisy print. From a distance, it looks just like a nice, pretty floral design. But up close, you can see that it's got the words Republican National Convention, it had Miami, Florida, and the date came as August 8, 1968. And these dresses were used to make, this fabric was used to make hostess dresses for 50 hostesses at the Republican National Convention that year. And then she went back to the Democrats and designed hostess dresses and a scarf for Vice President Hubert H. Humphrey. And of course, he ran for president in 1968. And for these dresses, which she called H-line dresses, which is a play on the popular A-line silhouette, so instead of an A-line dress, it's an H-line. So it's got the H front and back. but she wanted them to be both highly visible in the media, so like on TV and in photographs, you could really pick out these dresses, they'd stand out. And she also wanted them to be fashionable, kind of just beyond the novelty of this political season. And I think one of the best stories to show that they were appreciated just purely on their fashion's qualities was that her friend Betty Ford was in the shop picking out all the clothes that she was going to wear to the Republican National Convention. And she was trying on this dress because she thought it was really pretty. And then Frankie came in and was like, "Oh, Betty, take that off. You don't want to wear that to the Republican National Convention. It's for Hubert Humphrey." So Betty Ford was like, "Okay, I don't think I'll take it after all." But she appreciated the design. And the scarf you'll see for Humphrey has a reserve in the lower right-hand corner for Humphrey's signature. And for most designers, the only important signature was their own. That was kind of the focus of these signature scarves. But Frankie used signatures in lots of different ways and really made that an important aspect of her designs. So sometimes it would be a reserve like this where the design, the signature was pre-printed. Sometimes you would get a scarf with a blank reserve and you could take it like to Washington and have your favorite politician sign it. Or she would incorporate the signature somehow into the design. So you can kind of keep an eye out for signatures in the different scarves. This scarf is, you know, it's really early and it's unusual in that the only place her name is on the little tag that has the fabric content on the back so you don't see it. But after this, almost every scarf, I mean, 99% of the scarves have her name. She was, again, really good at branding. And she knew that women appreciated her designs and would appreciate having her name on their scarves, that it would make it more desirable. So Richard Nixon was the winner of the 1968 election, and Frankie ended up designing scarves for him that were given out at his inaugural ball. And the media certainly noticed Frankie's ability to be bipartisan or nonpartisan, and she believed that this was an important part of the success of her business. And she really liked to be able to say that Democrats and Republicans shopped side by side in her shop. And while she was definitely a voter, she was very careful about not sharing her political affiliations. If only. So after the amazing success Frankie experienced during the 1968 election, she especially the order of the Humphrey scarves, which was a really big order and gave her a lot of capital for expanding this business, she decided to grow the scarf design part of her business. So she put together a brochure about her scarves, and she sent it out to 5,000 American businesses, and she said that she could make them a scarf that was fashionable, and personalized, and that would be meaningful to the women who received it. And much of her scarf production focused on limited edition custom scarves that businesses or individuals or churches or museums or institutions could commission. And some of these were souvenirs of events, and some were swag at conferences, they were gifts to patrons, and they were used for fundraisers or incentives. She really could work out a way for anyone to want and need and use a scarf. And she loved selling the scarves. There are lots of great stories of her selling scarves. And she designed likely thousands of scarves from the late 60s through the 90s. And there is no master list of the scarves, unfortunately. So I don't know exactly how many she did, but now I want to share some scarves with you so you kind of get a sense of her body of work and the kind of scarves she made. And since we're in Georgia, I'll include a lot of Georgia ones. So this is one of her first scarves specifically for Georgia, and as you can see, it's a variation of the Discover America scarf, but she's added the words, "See Georgia First," in the background. So that was part of a kind of traveling promotion campaign for Georgia, "See Georgia First." And she introduced it in Rome in 1969 while she was there to be honored by a Frankie Welch Day. And she produced it in two colorways, so it had the brown and orange, like you see here, and then there was also a red, white, and blue version. And this scarf was used as part of the outfits worn by hostesses at Georgia Welcome Centers. And I haven't been able to find a photograph of one of the Welcome Centers yet, but one of my friends at the Hargrove found this photograph of Miss Hetty White, who was Miss C. Georgia First, and she's wearing a skirt made out of the scarves and with a scarf tied around her neck at the Georgia display at the Canadian National Exhibition in 1969. So this one is actually from the Russell Political Library at the Special Collections, And I should say that the credits for these photographs are primarily from the Hargrave Gray Book and Manuscript Library, the Rome Area History Center, and a lot of their photographs are going to be transferred to the Hargrave so that they can be kept better, and from Frankie's family. Yeah, being ogled, if you didn't notice that part. All right, and she also designed this scarf for the National City Bank of Rome in 1970. And a newspaper article about this scarf read, "Patrons of the National City Bank of Rome are in for a treat this coming week when premium gifts for opening or adding a savings account in the amount of $100 will be scarves designed by former Roman Frankie Welch." So it's kind of a big deal. This would, you get this scarf by this local celebrity, and it celebrated the history of Rome. It's got the Romulus and Remus sculpture, the clock tower, and then lists some historic sites along the way. And this was so popular that 8 years later, the bank commissioned a second scarf that they would use as premiums if you opened a checking account or expanded your banking services there. And again, it features historic sites around Rome. And as you see on the left, as you see on the left, often these scarves would come in a custom Frankie Welch envelope. They'd be folded over, and usually they'd have a flyer that had information about different ways you could tie the scarf or information about Frankie's career. And then this one had a brochure that explains about the different historic sites that are featured on the scarf. So you can see again, it's personal to Rome. She's really thought about what images go on it, and it would be meaningful for the people who received it. And the people in Rome still love finding these scarves. So this scarf is from 1970, and it is her 50 state flowers scarf. And it debuted on May, I see someone's got 50 state flowers in the back. It debuted on May Day at the Washington National Cathedral during the annual flower mart of the Garden Clubs of America. So again, she knew how to make a statement when she debuted these scarves. And this scarf received national attention. And part of it was this big debut, but part of it was there was cross-promotion with the cotton industry, Cotton Council. So this was printed initially on Supima cotton, which is kind of a luxury, high, long staple cotton. So Supima promoted it, and it was just in newspapers all across the country. And for this one, she took inspiration from the White House china that Lady Bird Johnson had ordered from Tiffany. And on the dessert plates, they had hand-painted all the state flowers. So Frankie used the idea of the state flowers. She put most of the state flowers in clusters around the border, but she selected one to go alone in the center, and it is Georgia's Cherokee Rose. And she said, "I'm the designer, I can do what I want." So she put the Cherokee Rose in the middle. And again, she used yardage of this scarf to make a garment. So it's this beautiful kind of 1970 pastoral garment. And again, she put the Cherokee Rose, kind of centered it right in the bust so it had a place of prominence. But it was a really beautiful scarf and popular. She also used it to make a dress for Betty Ford, which you see on the far image. And this is what Betty Ford wore when she first stepped out of her Alexandria home after she learned of Nixon's impending resignation. So this is what she wore when she knew that she was going to soon be First Lady. And it's kind of a brilliant choice because it's by an American designer, which is always important for a first lady. It's got a connection to the White House because of the inspiration from the china. And it represents all 50 states, just as the first lady was going to do. And Betty Ford wore a lot of scarves by Frankie and garments from her shop kind of before and while she was first lady. She was first lady from 1974 to 1977. And her presence in the White House really heightened Frankie's national reputation. And Frankie was often described in the media as the fashion advisor to the First Lady. So she's got in the color photo that is a members of the Senate scarf. She's got a Veterans Administration scarf, and this is an Indianapolis 500 scarf that she's wearing. She also designed a custom scarf with Betty Ford in 1975. It featured polka dots, which Betty Ford liked, petunias, which were her favorite flower, her signature, and actually, over in one of the cases, you can see the piece of paper where Betty Ford wrote out her signature a bunch of times, and then they clipped out one to use on the scarf. And then it has colors that match Betty Ford's favorite turtlenecks so that she could wear it with lots of her outfits. And they had a press conference at the White House to introduce it. So again, they got a lot of press mileage out of that. And Betty Ford had been getting some negative press at the time. Not for good reasons, but like she supported the ERA and things. So this gave her lots of good press. And when Betty Ford was asked to donate a dress to the Smithsonian's First Lady's collection, she of course didn't have an inaugural dress because of how her husband had come into office. But she selected one of her favorite dresses by Frankie, this dress here, and she only agreed to donate it to the Smithsonian after Frankie agreed to make her a duplicate. So there are two of those dresses out there, and one's in the Smithsonian. And that was, I think, one of the highlights of Frankie's career. That was a really special moment for her. And she could have invited anyone to the reception honoring the dress when it was officially donated, but she had her like third grade teacher and her high school home economics teacher and the first boy who ever invited her on a date. So, it was meaningful. But Frankie, first and foremost with her designs, wanted to be fashionable. So you can really trace the history of scarf fashion through her scarves. At least through the decades when she was making them. And her earliest ones were primarily squares on silk. Am I doing that? I'm not making them, okay. Primarily squares in silk or cotton. And then as we get into the early 70s, she moved to the smaller size, and she introduced her distinctive 8x8-inch module design. And she said that that was inspired by Frank Lloyd Wright, who often used modules in his architecture, so these repeated blocks of patterns. And so if you see this module design, it's almost always going to be Frankie Welch. So you can kind of spot that from across the antique store or the thrift store. She usually made her module scarves of 1x4 modules, like you see there. Though occasionally she'd make a 3x3 or a 2x4 or a 4x4. And then she would print yardage of these patterns to make Frankie's. She also would hem single modules. And she would call them napkerchiefs, which is a combination of napkin and handkerchief. So you could use it in lots of different ways, but those are two suggestions, napkins and handkerchiefs. And often in the 1970s and the first half of the 80s, her scarves were made of the popular synthetics of the era. That was what was fashionable then. So you see scarves that are made out of polyester and triacetate. And one material that she particularly favored was kyana, which is a silky nylon. And this was one of her earliest module scarves, and it came about after one of her friends from Rome was up in D.C. lobbying for support of libraries and feeling like she wasn't having much support, and that what would really help them was to have a Frankie Welch scarf. So she convinced the Georgia Libraries Association to commission these scarves, and they were introduced at a GLA conference on Jekyll Island in 1971. And the GLA asked her to recognize Georgia very subtly in the design. So she included the Library of Congress and Dewey Decimal Call numbers for books on Georgia. And I like thinking about this scarf, and you'll see this idea with other scarves as well, but she was kind of thinking ahead and designing it so that if she wanted to market this pattern to Tennessee or to Virginia, she could switch out the call numbers and continue using this design. So, you know, she's thinking about it from a design way, but she's also very much thinking about it from a business standpoint, because she's a very good business person. So anyway, I think that's interesting. I don't think she ever made this for other states, but that's okay with me. She made it for Georgia, and that's all that matters. Another scarf design she often reused was her Christmas trees design. And she created the design in the early 70s, but just reprinted it many times. Sometimes just with the trees, and sometimes in the border, she would add words like greetings from John and Jane Smith, or happy holidays from the Callahans, just whoever commissioned it. And she added a note to the one on the list. This is from her papers, and it reads, "This is a design that I manufacture every Christmas season, and everyone seems to buy 300 or more each year to put in their friends' pockets when they have a holiday party." So you kind of get a sense of how people were using those. And there are a couple of Christmas trees on eBay right now, just so. And partly because of the success of her Cherokee alphabet design, Frankie introduced other Native American-inspired designs, including this one of turtles from 1971. And the turtle motif is based on an image she saw on a piece of pottery in Arizona. So I do want to acknowledge that Frankie's Native American-inspired designs now can be understood as cultural appropriation. And that certainly generated a lot of discussion during the process of editing the book and of putting together the exhibition. It's a hot button topic, and it's a complicated, nuanced issue. So I acknowledge, yes, it is cultural appropriation. She wasn't living the life of a Native American. But I believe that Frankie handled it about as well as she could have at the time. She genuinely believed that she was part Cherokee. For her entire life, she believed she was part Cherokee because that's what her great aunt told her, her other family members. She worked with LaDonna Harris, who is Comanche, to get a clean copy of the syllabary when she first made the scarf. So she had input at the beginning. And she donated a percentage of the sale of each of the Cherokee alphabet scarves to a fund she'd set up for the education of the Eastern Band of the Cherokee Nation. So she was trying to do financially some good. Her intent, in part at least, was to raise awareness of the Cherokee, and she did. In 1998, so several decades later, at an event honoring Frankie's 30th anniversary in design, Helen Thomas, who is the famous White House correspondent and a friend of Frankie's, said that Frankie was the one person in the Washington area to, quote, raise our threshold of understanding about the Native Americans, especially the Cherokees. So also, you know, I've already talked about LaDonna Harris, but there were other prominent Native American women who wore her designs, both at the time and in the early 21st century, when Wilma Mankiller, who was the first female principal chief of the Cherokee Nation, used to wear the Cherokee alphabet scarf. You can find photographs and video of her wearing that scarf. Frankie's designs were also part of a larger vogue for Native American-inspired designs. So if you think about hippie fashion with leather and feathers and beaded elements, it's all part of that same expression or fashion impulse. And Frankie was all about being fashionable. So yes, it's cultural appropriation, but yes, it's complicated and nuanced. And I'll be glad to talk about it more later, but I'm gonna move on now. So back to the turtles. As with many of her designs, she produced turtles as a scarf. She printed yardage to make garments. She made little bikinis out of turtles, I think. And then she made Frankies out of this one, including little Frankies for the little girls. And when we had the opening, two of her great-granddaughters came wearing her original Frankie turtle dresses, and it was so sweet. They just walked around the gallery next to the, you know, the big-sized dresses. So in 1973, Frankie introduced a group of four more Native American-inspired designs that she promoted with Goldwater's department store out in Arizona. And one of those was based on Cherokee basket patterns. So you can see she collected all these Cherokee baskets, and then she used those designs to make a scarf, and then she used one of those designs on the cover of a book she wrote titled Indian Jewelry. So it talks about her kind of family history that she had been told about growing up in the Rhone area and finding arrowheads out walking around in the woods, about how to collect Indian jewelry, how to wear it and display it. So that's what the book was about. These Native American designs also fit into the theme of Americana for Frankie and her peers. And though always somewhat nebulous in meaning, in the 1960s and 70s, the term Americana generally suggested things like early American antiques or folk art or colonial revival designs, or really anything in a red, white, and blue color scheme. In fashion specifically, it could mean inspiration from the military, or the trappers of the frontier era, or iconic pastimes like baseball, as well as the use of fabrics associated with the Old West, like denim, or calico, or gingham. And the term typically indicated patriotism and nostalgia. And while the term Americana encompassed nearly all of her scarves, even the ones that are about kind of marketing and branding and politics, they especially apply to her Native American designs and the designs she created for the U.S. Bicentennial. So she designed numerous scarves for the 200th anniversary of the United States in 1976, including this one, which celebrates the original 13 states. Let's see. And the design was based on a souvenir button from George Washington's inauguration. And she had probably seen an example of this at the Smithsonian. So you can see it's got the GW in the middle and then the initials for the original. original 13 states. Most of her bicentennial scarves were officially part of the American Revolution Bicentennial Administration, which is a group created by Congress in 1973 to sort of promote and coordinate all these bicentennial events. But because of that affiliation, these scarves sold far and wide. They were not just in her shop, but she made lots of them, and they were sold in select department stores. They were sold in military exchanges around the world. So if you go looking for a Frankie scarf, this is the one you're most likely to find. She also enjoyed their celebration of American history and American presidents, because as I mentioned earlier, her husband had majored in, gotten his master's degree in U.S. history. Duval House, where she had her shop, is a place where George Washington had been. He had been to bank there when it was a bank. He'd been to drink there when it was a tavern. So she had, just the experience of shopping at Frankie Welch of Virginia was an Americana experience. And I've already talked about her connections to the Johnson White House and the Ford White House, but Frankie was a Georgia girl, so of course she had a connection to the Carters. But her connection actually predates their time in the White House. And she designed this scarf for them in 1973 while Jimmy Carter was governor of Georgia. And as the story goes, Rosalind had initially asked for a quilt design scarf, but so had the First Lady of Virginia, Catherine Godwin, and she had asked first, so she got the quilt design. And the Carters ended up with this peanut design because of Jimmy Carter's family business. But it turned out to be great. And these scarves were used as gifts while they were in the governor's mansion in Atlanta. And the first scarves were printed on silk, and then because they were so popular, they were reprinted on cotton. So the silk ones, you can see, it says first edition, and the cotton ones don't say that. Frankie also printed some yardage to make a Frankie dress. And I think this dress just has it all. It's by an American female designer from Georgia with a connection to the Carters. It's got peanuts. It's just really Americana fashion at its best, both sides here. And so the dress that you see on the left is in the collection at the Harvard at UGA. And on the right, you see Rosalind, you see Rosalind wearing a dress. And I don't know if she made multiples of these or if it's the same dress, but either way, it's a great design, and it was one of the first things that I saw of Frankie's, so it's part of my introduction to her work, so it remains one of my favorites. And because the first peanut scarf was so successful, when she was asked to design a scarf for Jimmy Carter's presidential campaign, they returned to the idea of peanuts, and she did these designs, and that is Frankie's son-in-law, Peggy's husband, Paige Williams, modeling the tie and pocket square in the new peanut pattern. And Frankie continued designing political scarves and scarves for inaugurations throughout her career. And this scarf, probably from 1978, is of Washington, D.C. And it's one of the scarves that she produced on a larger scale and sold in her shop and through a few department stores. She also liked to take this design, and if there was a group having a conference in D.C., she could add the hotel where they were staying, or there was a construction group that met, and she added some diggers and things in it. So, she could customize this scarf design as well. But if you look at it, it's not like your typical view of D.C., kind of a weird perspective. But what connects it to Georgia is that perspective, because as the story goes, it is the view from Max Cleland's office in the Veterans Administration. So I wasn't sure if the story was true, but I got on Google Maps, and I pinned the VA, and I went on Street View, and sure enough, that's exactly what you see. So, let's see. Max Cleland had a long career in politics, including as head of the VA from 1977 to 81, and they were good friends. Also, Frankie's husband, he died in 1975, but he spent a lot of his career as the congressional liaison to the Veterans Administration. So Frankie had strong ties to the VA, so that view kind of out the front door of that building would have been important to her. So here she is with Max Cleland, and she also designed this fabric that was used as a wall covering in his office. This is a scarf for the Garden Club of Georgia from 1978, and it celebrates their 50th anniversary. And Ms. Clark Duncan, we see here, of Buena Vista, Georgia, helped design this scarf, and they used it as a fundraiser for the garden club, and they sold them for $10 each. And so sometimes with these scarves, there will be someone else who's given credit, you know, co-credit for designing the scarves. And I think it probably varied from project to project exactly how much input this other person would have had, but probably what happened here is that Duncan Clark suggested that Frankie look at this garden design, which is from the Founders Memorial Garden at on campus, North Campus at UGA. So you can see it matches. And then the border along that is from some interior molding from the house where the garden club was founded. So these details have meaning, and they're probably suggested by Ms. Clark. And then usually with the designs, Frankie would kind of sketch out the original preliminary design, and then she would hire an artist to do a rendition that could be transferred to the screen printing process. This is a scarf for the University of Georgia President's Club from 1982, and it's a patrons group for UGA, and Frankie was a charter member. And it is based on architectural details from the ceiling of the President's home, so it's a mid-19th century building, and she looked at the details and made the scarf. And she sometimes liked to joke that this was her most expensive scarf, because to become a member of the President's Club, you had to donate at the $10,000 level, so it was a $10,000 scarf, because you couldn't get one any other way. She also designed tote bags. You can see a tote bag here. And I haven't shown very many tote bags, but Frankie was at the front end of the vogue for custom branded tote bags. I mean, now they're everywhere, so we kind of take them for granted, but when she was doing it, it was pretty new and innovative. And she, you know, I focused mainly on her scarves, but she did totes and ties and umbrellas, and occasionally she did tiles or paperweights or aprons or t-shirts. She really was a complete, irrepressible entrepreneur. And so it's also when she designed this scarf that she donated a large collection of her scarves to the University of Georgia. And I believe that that was the first such donation that she made to a university. But she went on to donate to other colleges and universities, especially ones with strong home economics or family consumer science programs, because she supported education and she recognized that her work could be used as an example for students to learn from and can see how things could be done. So putting her work in these collections has also, I think, helped to preserve her memory. Because I can see as people do projects at these different schools where her scarves ended up, you know, they're out there learning about her as well. And because she donated this large collection to UGA, that's why I was able to do this project. So that was some great foresight on Frankie's part. But these are mostly kind of archival or working collections that she put them into, so I've been working with her family to put some of her scarves into museum collections so that they can be recognized for her contributions to American fashion and for their design qualities. So the museum at the Rhode Island School of Design accessioned a couple of works, and the Cooper Hewitt National Design Museum has changed its name. Cooper Hewitt Smithsonian Design Museum accepted some work, so that's really exciting to see Frankie getting that recognition. And then kind of separate from our efforts, the Costume Institute at the Metropolitan Museum of Art recently had one of her Cherokee Alphabet Frankie dresses on display. So that was pretty exciting. And Frankie's daughters and granddaughters went and had their pictures made standing beside it. So here, I'm almost done. This is another scarf with architectural details. And the US Senate celebrated its bicentenary in 1989. And they started making plans for all the events that would go with it in 1983. So sometime between 1983 and 1989, Frankie designed this scarf for the US Senate. And it takes a lot of the details from the old Senate chamber. So back in 2015, one of these scarves was on eBay. As I mentioned at the beginning, I think eBay is a great resource. And one reason why is, like, when that scarf was on eBay, they also scanned or took a picture of a flyer that went with it that explains all the symbols that are used on this scarf. I haven't seen that flyer anywhere else, so I just have been saving all these pictures from eBay for years, and so I was able to go back with this scarf and write an individual label for it and kind of say what the different things mean. So it explains, and I'll just read bits from it here. Centered on the square block design is a shield, suggested by the escutcheon suspended above the Vice President's desk in the old Senate chamber. decorated with 13 stars and 13 stripes, denoting the original 13 states. Directly below is a small hourglass form, which represents the ivory gavel used in the Senate of his earliest days. The principal emblem, surrounded by the words United States Senate, rests on a field of 16 stars. This background was adapted from the star carpet in the old Senate chamber. The selection of 16 stars symbolizes the number of states in the Union in 1800 when the Senate first moved to the Capitol building. And it goes on to explain, so from the Capitol designs and from the fireplace designs, but it just explains all these details and how meaningful they could be to the people who wear them. And these black and white photographs are ones, again, that I found fairly recently in her designs, so you can see very directly where she's getting her sources. In the mid-80s, Frankie returned to mostly large silk square scarves and some cotton bandanas. The scarf on the left is for the U.S. Naval Academy's 30th anniversary of the class of 1960, so it was made in 1990. And it has tassels, because she was really into tassels at that time. She was kind of looking at her men's scarves and things like that. And then it's got architectural details from the Naval Academy's campus in Annapolis. And then this bandana is from BB&T, the bank, and it's covered in dollar signs, which I think is pretty great. And I don't have any more information than what's on this scarf. So there are a lot of scarves like that that would make a good small research project for someone to kind of go digging through the BB&T archives or talk to the right administrative assistant who's been there for a long time to figure out what the occasion was. Why did she do that? So anyway, tips. I'm happy to talk to anybody about this. Frankie's shop in Alexandria closed in 1990, and she stopped designing scarves around 1999. She was beginning to experience some signs of dementia at that point, and she retired to Charlottesville, Virginia, to be near her daughter Peggy in 2001, and then she died in September of 2021, so shortly before the book came out. Frankie Welch occupies an interesting place in American history. Some people remember her, and for them, it's like everybody knew who Frankie Welch was. But there are a lot of people for whom Frankie Welch is a new name. But as a female entrepreneur and a Southern designer, I think she was really quite remarkable. She created and followed her own career path to great financial success and fashion success and media acclaim. And her scars provide this kind of rich material history of our country, or at least for her circle of peers, during the later half of the 20th century. And they're just great examples of Americana fashion. It's something special that someone from Georgia made. And I've just shared a few of the scarves today, but each of the hundreds, if not thousands, of her scarves really kind of provides this rich window into American history and culture, and each one tells a story. They're pretty readily available on eBay. I checked this morning, there's a great selection. And if you keep your eye out at estate sales, there are quite a few around in Georgia. So thank you. I'll answer questions, or we can go touch scarves.